Hello everyone and welcome back to C++. Today we're going to be actually getting into some code, which is really exciting. And so a little bit before we start about our build environment here. This is an Ubuntu 12.04 VM, so it's freely downloadable from the internet. Just Google Ubuntu download or go to ubuntu.com and click the download button and choose desktop and 32-bit or 64-bit and run it in a VM. Virtualization software is absolutely free. You can look up VirtualBox. VirtualBox is what I'm using right now, and it'll allow you to very quickly set up a VM of Linux so that even if you're on Windows right now, you can run, like I am, I'm in Windows, you can run a VM of Linux. You can run Linux without having to shut down and reboot and install to your hard drive. Real, real easy to do virtualization. You can install it in a VM. If you don't understand that, don't worry. You can also run this in Windows. You can do all of this in Windows as well. There will be some key differences, which I'll mention, of things like, hey, this works in Linux but not in Windows, or vice versa. And for those, I'll usually switch over to Windows and show the alternate way to do that. This tutorial is not going to have any of that. The next couple will not have any of that. But once you start getting into things like networking, we'll start seeing that come up. So, anyway, if you have a Linux VM, awesome. Here's what we're going to do. Alternately, if you have a Windows machine that you're running on, Google CodeBlocks MingW download, and then it's going to be an installer. Step through the installer, and it should install a compiler, a C++ compiler, and the IDE, your integrated development environment. It makes coding a lot easier. So, go check that out, download and install. If you're on Windows, pause the video right now and go do that. If you're on Linux, stay tuned real quick as we're going to step through that manually. So, on Linux, on Ubuntu specifically, press Ctrl-Alt-T to open up a terminal window. If you don't want to do a keyboard shortcut, you can also go to this dash home and type in terminal and choose terminal here. Or if you're on an older version of Ubuntu and so you still have the old GNOME interface, or maybe you downgraded because you like the old one better, you can go up to the top left-hand corner to Applications, click, drop down to Accessories, and then go right over to Terminal. Click on Terminal there and it'll open up. We only need one of these though. So now that we have it open, you're going to type in sudo apt-get install g++. That will be in the description. You can copy and paste it in or type it in yourself. It's kind of small, I know, because this is 1080p video, but sudo apt-get install g++ apt-get. Press Enter. It'll ask you for your sudo password. Enter that. I've already installed it, so it's not going to install for me. But for you, if you haven't installed G++ already, it'll say, hey, you know, it's a X amount of kilobyte download, are you sure? And you'll press Y, the Y key, and then press Enter, and that'll say yes, confirm, and it'll allow it to install G++. Once it's done that, you have your compiler installed, and then you can go over to the Ubuntu Software Center, search for code blocks, and click on it, and click the Install button. That should be pretty easy. So, pause the video right now while you do that. And welcome back. So, you now have CodeBlocks installed and G++ installed, hopefully. The alternate way to do this is you can compile things from the command line. So say we have something called main.cpp or main.c++, which is our code. We can type g++ main.cpp o program, and that'll create a binary or a program called program. Obviously, this isn't going to work because we don't have a main.cpp file. We haven't written any code yet, but that's how you would compile if you want to do it through the command line and skip the whole code blocks thing. You don't need code blocks, but it's nice when you get into bigger projects to be able to manage them in an IDE and have that syntax highlighting. And when you want to run that program, you type /program and it would run. Of course, that program is never created because we didn't have source code to convert into binary and compile and create object files and link. And so we don't have a program right now. That's okay. But those are the commands that you'd normally use to compile a source code file called main.c++ and create a program called quote program, and then run program as /program. So we can close the terminal out. We're going to be working in an IDE, so go ahead and open up code blocks. It'll ask you real quick what compiler do you want to use, and choose GNU GCC compiler. That's the default, that's the one we just installed. If you have others installed that you prefer and you know you prefer, you can go with those, but might as well just stick with what you know. So choose the GCC GNU compiler. You can close this little tip of the day. It's not important. It's a tip. So then you're going to be in code blocks. You're going to go up to File, New, Project. And in Project, you're going to choose Console Application because we're working with just text-based for now. We're not doing any graphics, and we're not doing any fancy projects or creating libraries or anything like that. It's just going to be a console application. So choose that and click Go. Then this window will pop up. You can check this, skip this page next time you don't need it. Click Next. Make sure this is on C++. Next, project title, Tutorial 1. Choose somewhere to put it. Home, Max, Programming, Tutorial 1. If that's not where you want it, or wherever it chooses by default to put it, click this little button with three periods in it, and browse to wherever you want to put it. Cancel. So you can leave this and this alone. Click Next. Make sure that GNU, GCC compiler, is chosen from this drop-down menu. There are other options. Don't choose them. Leave these checked. Doesn't really matter. Click Finish, and you'll have a brand new project. So you might want to pause and make sure you're all cut up and got a new project with this main.cpp here. And welcome back. So this main.cpp, we can double-click on it to open it. Now delete everything in there. Oh my god, don't look. That is a Hello World program. We're going to be writing almost an identical one. However, we're going to write it ourselves, so delete it. Now, if you're taking this language as a class, you're taking a C++ class, you're going to want to pay attention to the syntax, not the syntax, the nomenclature for C++ programming. It's the technicalities, it's what comp sci people love to spew around. They're not really important. You don't have to know what's called a stream insertion operator or a preprocessor directive to be able to use it and understand what it does, but these are the technical names. So, without any knowledge of programming at all, you're going to have to transition over a little bit from the natural language of English or whatever your native language is. Hopefully you understand English if you're watching this tutorial, otherwise it's going to be slightly confusing. Un poco. But what you're going to want to do is you're going to want to transition. You're going to want to think, all right, well, in English, I can tell someone, hey, get me a Coke, and they open it up and they bring you a Sprite because they know you like Sprite. There's not that allowance for error in C++ or in programming in general. There's not that forgiving attitude. There's not that ability to say, oh, well, we know what you meant. No, it doesn't know what you mean. You have to tell it exactly what you want. Now, there's different levels of how precise you need to be as far as, can you say, get me a Sprite, or can you say, walk over to the fridge, open it, give me a Sprite, close the fridge, and bring it over here, or can you say, do you have to teach them how to use their arm first? You know, their arm architecture. Bad pun. There are a lot of different variants depending on which language you're using as to how much detail you need to go in, but you always need to be specific. Whether you need to be precise, but you always need to be you always need to be very precise, but specificity, how specific you need to be about something, varies from language to language. Anyway, keep in mind that you will have to be very, very exact as to what you want, and any small mistakes will catch up to you. I guarantee you, if you code long enough, you will have the embarrassing moment of spending 20 minutes looking for a compiler error in some cryptic library or some odd thing that's going on, only to find you missed a semicolon. If you don't know any programming, you'll see why that's very, very embarrassing in a few moments. But whenever you do that, you feel really dumb for like the next couple hours. So little things happen that you think, oh, well, why couldn't it just insert that automatically? Sorry, it can't. So definitely, definitely, definitely make sure you are writing this code down to a T. There is, of course, a download link in the description below to a online copy of the source code if you want to make sure you got it right, or even just copy and paste it or whatever. But definitely important to make sure that you get all the source code typed absolutely correctly, or else you will have, of course, problems. So let's start. We're going to start with a preprocessor directive. That sounds like kind of a natural thing to start with, something that's pre. It happens before you do something, right? A preprocessor directive like this, include IOStream, is going to take the code in IOStream and bring it in. So imagine that IOStream is this huge file of code. It's actually a header. And in that header, it has maybe some code and a lot of references to other places where code exists. But you can just simplify this to think of one huge file with a ton of code inside of it. That's IOStream. IOStream is going to provide a lot of the real basic things that we're going to be using. So IO and stream, let's take that apart. IO usually stands for input-output, and stream sounds like maybe some way to move data around. So IOStream, maybe we're moving some data in and out. So IOStream makes sense. The beauty of includes is that you don't have to reinvent the wheel to make a car. You can make a really advanced program without having to build everything from the ground up. That's the beauty of computers and programming. Everything builds on everything else. As you move around in programming, you will find things have already been done for you. And it turns out to be very, very convenient. If you have to reinvent the wheel to make a car, well, then you still got to worry about the engine, and there's a lot of other problems. Your job as a programmer is to create the engine. The wheels and the frame and the air it moves through and physics should already be figured out for you. So that's kind of the idea behind including. So if you watch my Java tutorials, you remember import java.util.scanner or .wildcard, the asterisk, and then imports a lot of different things. that's similar to IOStream. IOStream is going to provide things that have similar functionality to things like scan and print and things like that. We're going to be able to, print isn't part of util, but these kind of basics that we're going to be using are in IOStream. So you'll see a lot of programs will be using IOStream. In older implementations, if you're using a really old computer, try iostream.h if you're having trouble compiling. That'll specify, hey, it's a header file, compiler, look for something.h. So the preprocessor directive include iostream is going to take all the code from iostream, copy it, and paste it in and replace this line with all that code. The important part of that is now that we have that code in our project, we can use it. So we can, while we're writing our code, pretend that it's already been copied and pasted into here and just have it acknowledge the fact that that code is going to be copied and pasted by including it. So, we're good with that. Then the next line is using namespace std. Okay, it's not sexually transmitted disease, it is standard, the standard library. A namespace is a library. Think of a library like your public library. You go in and you can find a lot of books. Each book is an object and you can go through and find different information from them. And these are magical books. You can tell them to do things like get you coffee. So anyway, std is going to be a library, and it's going to have a lot of things inside, objects, classes, that we can use, that have already been written for us. Similar to the includes, but it's not a preprocessor directive per se. It's talking about actually using a namespace std, so it's basically appending std onto things that come from the std library. What does that mean? Well, let's create, and I'll come back to this line, int main, but say we have something like cout. Hello, C++. But there's two pluses. And all. Okay, so, not explaining any of this code right now, but cout comes from std. If we weren't using this namespace std, if we remove this line, then to make this work, we type std colon colon cout to refer to say, hey, this comes from std. Now, you see now that we did std, our IDE is going to show us all these things that I can pull from std, which end up being extremely useful later on. But for now, we're just worried about cout, and cout is a stream, which we'll talk about in just a minute, but it's going to allow us to move data around in some fashion. So let's put this using namespace std back, and we can remove this. So using namespace tells us, hey, we're sitting in the library, so when I say cout, I don't have to tell you what library to go to find the book, I just have to tell you the name of the book, and you're already in the library, is the analogy I was trying to make that I danced around and failed to make earlier. So, you're already in the library, and you're looking for a book. You don't have to tell it the address of the library first. It's going to assume that we're in this library. So, cout. Cout is a string. Oh, before we talk about that, let's talk about this declaration here. This is a method. It's also called a function. It just depends on who you ask. There are some standards that dictate various ways in which to call it. I'm going to probably call it a method. That's just me. But main is going to be where our computer starts running. You can give a computer an infinite amount of code, but if you don't tell it where to start and what order to go in, it's not going to be very useful. It'll compile a lot of times, but it won't be useful. It won't do crap. It'll just kind of sit there and be like, hey, look at all this code I'm not using. You don't want that. You want the code you write to actually run and do some kind of function, correct? So we can define this int main. Main's going to be our starting point. Main, kind of a main plaza, you're going to start right there, and then you're going to start following the instructions someone gives you. Maybe there are driving directions. Maybe you start on Main Street and you have to go north. I don't know, that's a weird analogy. But you're going to start at main, and then you're going to go sequentially through the lines. So if we had multiple lines of code, it's going to go top to bottom. And inside of code, there's actually an order of operations that will occur. We'll talk about that when we get into more complex statements. But when we start talking about more complex code, we'll get into these order of operations, so even within the line, some things will run before other things, which is very, very important to things like overload operators functioning correctly. Again, we'll get into that. Don't worry about that now. Just a tantalizing view of the future, I guess. It probably just sounded kind of complicated. Anyway, we're going to click that little button. I just clicked the gear with a little play button, and that's going to run our program. Yay, your first C++ program, more than likely, unless you're just brushing up and you're like, I already know all this. Anyhow, that's going to be your first program. It's going to say, hello, C++. Exclamation mark, enter, process return 0x0. This in here is just saying hex, it's 0 in hex. Execution time 0.091 seconds, press enter to continue, enter to close. The rest of this information isn't part of our program, it's information about our programs running. So how long it took to run, things like that. So we can press enter, close that out. We can also press a little X. And let's modify this program a little bit. And let's talk about this line. So cout is a stream. Streams, when you're coming from another programming language that doesn't have streams, like maybe C, streams are an interesting concept. You can picture them, even though it's a difficult analogy to make, you can picture them like a river or a stream. A stream in real life with water running through it, unlike some of the rivers nowadays, which are actually dry. Anyhow, these rivers are going to have water running through them, and we're going to be able to put things in that river and then later get them out, send them downstream or even upstream. So we can use this, again, if you're in a C++ class and you want to know the technical term, the stream insertion operator. It's basically just this little double less than signs, and it's going to allow you to insert this package, this hello C++! Exclamation mark. It'll allow you to put it in a little box and float it down the river to someone else, and then someone else will grab it, right? So we're putting this into the stream. And then that stream is going to end at some point, or is going to be intercepted at some point, and whatever we put in is going to be taken out and used, likely in the order that we put it in. So if we put in hello C++ first and then an endl, this hello C++ will reach it first, then the endl will reach it, which means this will be couted, if you will, before endl is couted. That's not really a word. But cout, stream insertion, a string, this is a string literal. A string is just a collection of characters. Characters are letters, numbers, symbols, spaces. Space is a symbol. Just a bunch of characters that are in a row. So when we get into arrays, a string will be implemented as an array of characters. But for now, you can just think of them as string literals. It's words, it's sentences, it's anything you can fit between two quotes and still stays blue is going to be a string. A string literal. So we take this string literal and we insert it into our stream. String literal into a stream. Hope I said that right the first time. Put it in a little floaty box, throw it into the river, and hope somewhere down the stream the right person says, oh, hey, that's my package. That is a really ancient form of Amazon. Anyway, so you're going to put this little package in the stream. The stream is going to pull it out at some point, or something's going to pull it out of the stream. This is an O stream, an output stream. We'll talk about that later, too. And it's going to be able to then take that package and use it at some point. So when we run this, you will see that hello C++ at some point gets printed out, which means this console at the is laying at the end of this stream, for the analogy to work, is laying at the end of the stream, and so when hello C++ goes all the way down the stream, it gets to the terminal, and the terminal is like, oh, the terminal is this text interface, by the way, the terminal is like, oh, hey, look, a package, and opens it up, and then displays it. Hello C++. This endl you can't actually see at work, so let's remove it. It's not an actual character, well, it technically is a character, but like not a visible character. So we'll close that out, we'll build and run again, and see how it changed. You'll notice there used to be another line here, an enter a blank line. This endl, that's not right. This endl stands for end line. End line is basically saying do a return, so press enter. And again, if this is confusing, bear with me. If you can get this concept down, and the next few videos concepts down, then everything's going to be smooth sailing from there, I promise. Like, 90% promise. So, we can take this endl and insert it into the stream, and that's going to say, alright, end this line, start a new line. So say we were in something like gedit, or text editor, as Ubuntu calls it. And we were the program, and we were writing stuff out to the console. And so we're writing out, hello C++. Plus, why am I not able to type tonight? And then I'm just sitting there, and then I reach an endl. Oh, return. Endl also flushes the stream. Now, there's something important to talk about with implementations. There are different implementations of C++. What that means is that different operating systems, different platforms, different compilers have a slightly different way of changing C++ code into assembly. And some do things that others don't. Some, aka most, modern compilers, this won't even be an issue, but it's something to keep in mind, kind of a throwback to older C++ work, is the endl flushes the stream. So basically, if you imagine the stream's kind of low on water, it throws another bucket of water in to make sure that stuff gets to its destination. Maybe more than a bucket, I mean, we are talking about a river. Maybe like, you know, a hose, and turns on the hose, because it's a stream. It's not really a flush. Anyhow, it puts more water in the stream and makes sure those things get to their destination. So that flush just makes sure that whatever's sitting on the buffer, and a buffer is like a temporary place to store data while you're working with it, it's going to flush that buffer out and push that buffer out onto the terminal. Endl's not too important nowadays. This works perfectly fine in 99% of the cases. And it's also good to understand both. When you have this backslash, it means it's going to be a special character. So I'm not actually going to print out and see a backslash n in my console. It's going to interpret this and say, oh, that's, he's saying he wants an enter or a new line character, which is a real thing. They also have this for tab. But anyway, a new line character. So let's run that and see that we get that extra line once it, yeah, there we go. See this extra line right here? Hello C++, enter. So this new line, in this case, worked almost exactly like the endl. In modern implementations, it'll get flushed automatically and you don't have to worry about it, but in older implementations, if the buffer's getting stuck and things aren't printing out right, you might want to do an endl. Endls are generally going to be slightly more CPU intensive, which means they're going to use more processing power, but it's minuscule. If you're printing out that much stuff that you're worried about the processing power that an endl takes up, then you seriously have to consider why you're printing out that much stuff to a terminal. There's, other, of course, other uses for streams, in which case you probably wouldn't be using endl until the end because you're not expecting the user to see immediate output. For example, if you're writing out to a file, you wouldn't have to flush it every time. You can write out a bunch of lines and then flush. That way you aren't using up clock cycles, flushing data that can just be flushed later. Always save work till later. So, cout, hello C++, we're going to insert this with the stream insertion operator for any of you taking a class with a professor's... like, what is this symbol called? And you're like, well, I know exactly what it does, and I could use it in any implementation, but the exact name, I don't know. Kind of a funny thing about education. The stream insertion operator is going to allow you to take this package, and take this package, and take whatever any other packages, and insert them into the cout stream, which is an output stream, and that output stream is going to flow into the terminal. And whatever you flush into there is going to get output onto the terminal. So much for my idea of running short videos. And now we're going to talk about one last final thing, which are comments. Hopefully all this made sense so far. If it didn't, feel free to leave a comment below. I'd be happy to make additional clarification on these things. Now, comments are very useful because when future you looks back at code, a lot of times you'll be like, what was this doing or why did I write this? And it's really nice to have comments that in English explain the general purpose of the code to say, hey, this does this or hey, this does that, instead of leaving it ambiguous, and then you have to go through and be like, okay, well, we're taking a substring of n pause minus 4, which would be 4 from the n, so that'd probably be dot something something something, so maybe like an extension, so it's finding the name of the file without the... No, you don't want to do that. Comment finds name of file without extension. And then you can, oh, that's what that does. And then you look at the code, and you're like, oh, that makes sense, okay, cool. And you keep going. So it's easy to make code easy. It's good for making code easy to come back to. It's also good when you're working in some kind of collaborative environment with other people. Everyone writes code differently, which is kind of, it's both a really cool thing because you can talk to someone else and they'll have some novel idea for how to implement some algorithm you were struggling with because they think of, oh, why don't we do it this way instead of the way you're currently doing it, which you're running into roadblocks with or something of that nature. So it's really helpful, but when you're all sharing code, sometimes you're like, well, what does this code do? Why does this guy use ternary operator so much? Why can't he just, you know? And if you add a comment, then all of a sudden, oh, I see what that does. Oh, that's what he's trying to do. Or you can leave a comment. To do, this is broken. It should, you know, dot, dot, dot. And then someone else can go in and be like, oh, well, like, here's why it's broken and fix it. Then add a comment saying, fixed it, here was the problem, now works, pass test 3, 4, and 5. So comments are great for communicating to yourself, to your future self, to your past self if you figure out time travel, and they're also amazing for communicating between people when you're in a collaborative programming environment, which of course is the best way to program. Depends on your style. Comments can be double slashes. Double slashes, anything after on that line after double slash is going to be ignored. So we can type in, this will be ignored. The compiler is going to go through, and basically when it's running, it's just going to delete this. It's going to say, oh, whatever. It's a comment. It's going to ignore it. However, in your source code, it'll leave it there for you to be able to look back on. It's not going to delete it from your source code, but it will ignore it completely when it's actually generating code. I've actually seen people put things in the code, in the comments that are supposed to be like, all right, this needs to add two numbers, then they never implement it, and they expect the computer to be able to read this and say, oh, we need code to add two numbers. Computers don't read comments, and if they could, they wouldn't. So don't put anything in a comment for the computer. It's always for humans. It's human readability. It's allowing your code to be understood by you in the future and others. It has nothing to do with the computer. The computer doesn't care. The other type of comment is a multi-line comment. So that was a single-line comment. Then on the next line, whatever we do, will be completely separate. So this will be, of course, it'll throw a compiler. It'll be like, what are you trying to pull here? But this will, if this were a valid line of code, this would run. However, this would not. Then there's something called the multi-line comment, which is one slash and then an asterisk. And then you can do stuff on a bunch of different lines. And then when you're finally done, asterisk, slash. That is going to allow you then, this is the slash under the question mark, by the way. And that's going to allow you to then say, everything on all these lines is going to be a comment. Compiler, ignore all of this. So this is great if you need like a lengthy explanation for something, maybe in front of a really, really big method. You want like a 4 or 5 sentence explanation. This does this, it passes these conditions, and maybe give some specifics as to, you know, if it gets passed a number and has to divide by 0, it'll throw this kind of exception, or it'll modify this variable in memory, or be sure to pass only strings that have been cleansed, or things like that. You know, you can put a lot of instructions in these multi-line comments. One of the standards that a lot of people do is they put an asterisk in between, in front of each additional line. That's purely cosmetic. So, speaking of cosmetics, kind of, these enters are optional. These enters are somewhat kind of optional. Like, you'll see this will still build and run just fine. This will still build and run just fine. Why you'd want to write code like this, I don't know. I've actually seen it in a lot of programming projects, though. When they want all of something to be on one line, they will do that. You can see it runs perfectly fine. These enters are for, again, human readability. They make stuff easier to read and faster to understand. They are purely for looks. They are purely for the visual appeal of your code and to make things easier on the eyes. There's absolutely no reason, speaking as far as a compiler, for these spaces, these enters, these tabs here to exist. They're simply for organization and readability. So that being said, thank you for joining me. Next time we'll be talking about variables and how we can store numbers. Then we'll be making, in the tutorial after that, a program that will accept user input. They can enter like 2 numbers and it'll add them together or multiply them or something, give them the result. And maybe in there we'll start talking a little bit about order of operations, but probably not too much. So I'm going to try to start this out fairly easy and go kind of slow. Again, if you have any questions, feel free to leave a comment below. Also, there's a link to the source code. This is some very simple source code, but there's a link to it in the description below. And I will see you next time. Hopefully you understood the tutorial, and good luck with programming.